All right, good morning.
Good morning.
For those of you who have announcements, please come forward.
Good morning. I have organized an all-day prayer vigil for Jacob Murdoch. It will be all day Tuesday from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. I have a schedule downstairs. You can sign up for the time that you wish to do this. You can pray from home or from work. Probably be best if you use your break time or wherever you happen to be at that time. Just stop and say a prayer for Jacob. That's it. And if you want to sign up for more than one time, feel free to.
Well, the big day is finally here. Let's hope the Pats can deliver one more time. Applause. As you watch the game today, you're going to be hearing all kinds of statistics. They never stop. Rushing yards, passing yards, field goal attempt, whatever, you know. So I just wanted to share some statistics about our food pantry and the First Baptist pantry, and hope those numbers stick in your head. First of all, we're up to 764 items. We have one more week to go. I think we're going to make it. And last year, thanks to your donations of food, we were able to serve 40 families out of our little closet, and that's 129 people. Of course, the First Baptist pantry can see that many people in a single week. So the need is great, and you know, keep it coming. Last week, to talk about football. Next Sunday, it's all about the love. So if you're motivated by that, keep bringing stuff. Thank you.
Thank you.
So some of you know that St. Luke's sponsored a Boy Scout and Cub Scout group in the past, and we have been working to resolve their matters. They're resolving their accounts or getting their equipment out to different parties. But one of the things they've done in resolving things is they put together $850 here, and they have noticed our work on the parsonage and the new windows out there. So they are making an $850 cash contribution to the next phase of windows in the parsonage to button that up to make it safe and warm for our pastor in the winter.
Do we have any other announcements? All right, well, let us join our hearts and minds together in the spirit of worship. beautiful. Well, good morning again, everybody. Welcome to St. Luke's United Methodist Church. Great to see you all here today. Those of you watching us at home, thanks for joining us. We appreciate you taking time from your busy schedules to spend a little bit of time, spend an hour worshiping our Lord Jesus Christ with us. So yes, it's been a busy week, and I'll fill you in on details later. But February. It's February. Can you believe it's February?
Yeah.
It's like, where did it go? I mean, yesterday was Christmas, right? It's February, which is in our nation is considered to be Black History Month. And what's significant to me about Black History Month is it's, to me, it's really kind of more of anti-discrimination against everybody month. It just so happens that the African American people in this country, along with the Native Americans, were among the first to be heavily discriminated against. But unfortunately, the United Methodist Church, well, the United Methodist Church started in the 1960s, but our predecessor, the Methodist Episcopal Church, was not free from this problem of prejudice for many, many years. And what happened was that, well, there was some rampant discrimination against African Americans within the Methodist Church itself, which was an unfortunate thing, which didn't get corrected until, well, many decades later, almost a century, over a century later, really. As a result of that, there was a splinter church known as the AME, or African Methodist Episcopal Church, that grew out of what was known as the Free African Society. The Reverends Richard Allen, Absalom Jones, and other free blacks had established a new church in Philadelphia. And what happened was is they left St. George's Methodist Episcopal Church of Philadelphia because they were being discriminated against. And although Allen and Jones were both accepted as preachers, they were limited to black congregations. In addition, the blacks were made to sit in separate galleries that were built in the church when their portion of the congregation increased. So these former members of St. George's made plans to transform their mutual aid society into an African congregation. And although the group was originally non-denominational, eventually the members wanted to affiliate with existing denominations. Now, the Reverend Allen led a small group who resolved to remain Methodist. And they formed the Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church in 1793. And in general, they adopted the doctrines and form of government of the Methodist Episcopal Church, along with Wesleyan theology, like we do today. And in 1794, the Bethel AME Church was dedicated with Allen as the pastor. Allen successfully sued in the Pennsylvania courts in 1807 and 1815 for the right of his congregation to exist as an institution independent of the white Methodist congregations. Okay. Because black Methodists in other mid-Atlantic communities also encountered racism and desired religious autonomy, Allen called them to meet in Philadelphia in 1816, and they formed a new Wesleyan denomination known as the African Methodist Episcopal Church, or AME Church. Now, the AME Church was recently in the news down in South Carolina when a young man walked in and shot up a prayer meeting. You may remember that story. He was currently on trial for that. So they started out with 8 clergy, 5 churches, and by 1846, they had 176 clergy and 296 churches and over 17,000 members. And although they never actually joined the United Methodist Church, we still enjoy some very close ties with our AME brothers and sisters, because we are ultimately all followers of the teachings of John Wesley. They emphasize preaching the gospel, feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, housing the homeless, cheering the fallen, providing jobs for the jobless, and administering to the needs of those in prisons, hospitals, nursing homes, asylums, mental institutions, senior citizens' homes, caring for the sick, the shut-ins, the mentally and socially disturbed, encouraging thrift and economic advancement, and of course, bringing people back into the church. Sounds an awful lot like us. So, there are many different flavors of Methodists. Unfortunately, this particular branch of Methodism grew out of our discrimination. Let us hope that we will learn from this lesson going forward within the United Methodist Church and make our church a more welcoming place to be for everyone, regardless of race, creed, color, or sexual orientation. And now I'd like Pastor Nori to open us in a word of prayer.
Pray with me, church, pray with me. O God, whose holiness is not limited to grand cathedrals or saintly person or spectacular mountains or mountain-moving leaders, but your holiness is often discovered in simple everyday places and simple everyday folk like us. Plant your holiness in this place, plant your holiness in us, O God. Grow us this hour, grant us understanding and spiritual discernment, so that others may see you through us. We give you back all the glory. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please rise as you're able and join me to the call to worship. This new day is fresh with possibility to encounter the living Christ. With bright eyes, let us search.
This new day is fresh with possibility to understand the living Christ. With engaged minds, let us ponder.
This new day is fresh with possibility to be moved by the living Christ. With compassionate hearts, let us feel.
This new day is fresh with possibility to respond to the living Christ. With solid devotion, let us follow.
This new day is fresh with possibility to serve the living Christ. With humble intention, let us act.
This new day is fresh with the possibility to praise the living Christ. With strong voices, Let us sing and worship.
Amen. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, number 2173 in your black hymnal, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Kids?
Join me in our opening prayer. Lord, we come to you in a time of coldness and darkness, looking for warmth and light. There are those whose homes are physically freezing, and there are those whose lives are spiritually chilling. We know that we can help warm people's homes. We also know you can warm our lives. We pray that there will be no more gloom in our anguish. We pray that you lift away our burdens. We pray you remove the things that oppress people's lives. Lord, your light calls us forth to follow and serve you. Your light still shines for all to see in this world. May we continue to reflect your light in our lives, in our service, in our words, and in our deeds. Amen.
Please be seated. Kids. Okay, move further here. Okay. Come on, sit down. New glasses, huh? Okay. I want you to taste something, okay? Why? Uh-oh. You don't trust Pastor Nori? Give me your hand. Okay, taste it, okay? But don't say anything yet, okay? Okay, taste it. Okay. What is it?
Salt.
Okay, I'm glad. You know, at Pleasant Street, two children said it's sugar. It's salt. Okay. So you can also see our altar, right? Okay. Salt. Okay. Because today we will be talking about salt of the earth and light of the world. Jesus was talking to the disciples, Sermon of the Mount, that He said to the disciples, you are to be the salt of the earth. The same thing Jesus is telling you kids, you are the salt of the earth. Okay? What are the uses of salt? Tell me. To flavor food? Any other uses that you know? It's okay. Flavor is good enough. Flavor. Do you know what it means when Jesus is saying, you must keep the flavor in you, kids, because you are the salt of the earth? Anything that comes up into your mind before I say something? Okay, spread Christ. Also, flavor, be happy. You remember our song last week, right? We'll sing it next time, okay? Be happy. It means good works. Your flavors, your good works as a child of God. Spread the word of Christ. What else? How will you treat other people? Nicely? Kindly? Okay? Lovingly? If somebody hurt you and is apologetic to you, what will you say to them?
Thank you.
And so that means forgiving, right? You have to be forgiving, okay? So these are like example of flavors in your life, even though you're a kid, you know? So be the salt of the earth. Continue to be Christ-like children, okay? So I wonder if our girls can pray. Angelina, will you try, Angelina? Next time. I'm trying every Sunday. It's okay? Maybe next time, right? You can write something. Mom, Grandma, Mom, write something and maybe they can read it. Okay? Please, okay? We can read prayers too, okay? Okay, Michael.
Dear God, we pray to you to hope that you will teach us in how to be the salt of the earth, mm-hmm. to spread kindness and flavor to everybody, mm-hmm. to be forgiving and happy to those around us, mm-hmm. and to our inner spirit, and to show that we will have peace with ourselves and others. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you.
Our first scripture reading this morning is from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Dear brothers, even when I first came to you, I didn't use lofty words and brilliant ideas to tell you God's message. For I decided I would speak only of Jesus Christ and his death on the cross. I came to you in weakness, timid and trembling. And my preaching was very plain, not with a lot of oratory and human wisdom, but in the Holy Spirit's power, was in my words, proving to those who heard them that the message was from God. I did this because I wanted your faith to stand firmly upon God, not on man's great ideas. Yet, when I am among mature Christians, I do speak with words of great wisdom, but not the kind that comes from here on earth, and not the kind that appeals to the great men of this world, who are doomed to fall. Our words are wise because they are from God, telling of God's wise plan to bring us into the glories of heaven. This plan was hidden in former times, though it was made for our benefit before the world began. But the great men of the world would not have understood it. If they had, they never would have crucified the Lord of glory. That is what is meant by the scriptures, which say that no mere man has ever seen, heard, or even imagined what wonderful things God has ready for those who love the Lord. But we know about these things because God has sent his Spirit to tell us, and his Spirit searches out and shows us all of God's deepest secrets. No one can really know what anyone else is thinking or what he is really like except that person himself. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own Spirit. And God has actually given us his Spirit, not the world's spirit, to tell us about the wonderful free gifts of grace and blessing that God has given us. Please rise as you're able for the gospel reading. Our gospel reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. You are the salt of the earth, the world's seasoning, to make it tolerable. If you lose your flavor, what will happen to the world? And you yourselves will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. You are the world's light, a city on a hill, glowing in the night for all to see. Don't hide your light under a bushel. Let it shine for all. Let your good deeds glow for all to see, for they will praise your heavenly Father. Don't misunderstand why I have come. It isn't to cancel the laws of Moses and the warnings of the prophets. No, I came to fulfill them and to make them all come true. With all the earnestness I have, I say, every law in the book will continue until its purpose is achieved. And so if anyone breaks the least commandment and teaches others to, he shall be the least in the kingdom of heaven. But those who teach God's law and obey them shall be great in the kingdom of heaven. But I warn you, unless your goodness is greater than that of the Pharisees and the other Jewish leaders, you cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God. Please remain standing for one of my favorite hymns, This Little Light of Mine, number 585 in your red hymnal.
Little light of mine, come your light of shine. This little light of mine, come your light of shine.
be seated. I know a different, right? I was about to sing like, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it, but it's good. Good to learn another rhythm. Thank you, choir, thank you so much. Okay, the title of my sermon is Innate Qualities and Functions, Salt of the Earth and Light of the World, okay? Let's try this one, okay? Innate Qualities and Functions, Salt of the Earth and Light of the World. It's working, okay? I have a clicker. Okay, for the last 3 weeks, our gospel reading is very specific about discipleship, okay? Calling of the disciples. January 18, Jesus said, come and see. Okay, January 22, Jesus said, follow me. January 29, last week, Jesus began teaching and he taught the disciples the Beatitude, right? Okay, and for today, Jesus continues to teach about discipleship. He points out the two innate qualities of a follower of Jesus. Okay, these are the must-have innate qualities and functions of the disciples and also of the 21st disciples. And Jesus is reminding us, those who believe in him, that we cannot have an identity amnesia. Okay? We cannot have an identity amnesia. I'm gladly smiling. We cannot be distracted or drawn toward false words or worldly wisdom because we will lose sight of who we really are, okay? So the innate must-have qualities and function of a believer and a follower must always be within us. We should be salt of the earth and we should be light of the world. Let us read this verse.
Let us read it.
So he reminded us, salt of the earth, and then he presses a question in the midst of their identity. What happens when salt loses saltiness? Okay, let's go back to the ancient times. Ancient times, salt had been used for barter, for trade. Okay, and in the early years of the Roman Empire, roads were also actually constructed and built for the transportation of this product. Okay, wars have been fought over salt. Would you believe that? Okay. And Venice fought and won a war with Genoa. Genoa is a city in Italy because of salt. And today, salt is universally available. Okay, I want to ask you now, what are the uses of salt? Lynn? Okay, used to preserve food, meat. Okay, what else? Beth? Put on the roads, okay? But those salt that we don't eat, that salt, okay? Those are different kind of salt. What else? So salt melts, okay? What else?
Gives flavor.
What else?
Kills things.
Bacteria especially, okay? Kills. What else? Okay. I'll give you some uses of salts also. If you sprinkle salt on your shelves, it will keep the ants away. Okay? Okay. If you soak fish in salt water before descaling, okay, the scales will come off easier. I know it's not a practice here normally. You buy it already scaled. Back home, you know, I scale, but I never practice this. Okay, I will tell my mom. Okay. Another one, use salt to clean your discolored coffee pot. Okay, so team A, team B, team C. Okay, remember that, okay? Add a little salt also to the water if you cut your flowers because it will stand in for a longer time. Okay, I didn't know this, okay? Jackie, this is for you, okay? Use a mixture of salt and lemon juice to clean piano keys. I see. Why didn't you tell us that? Okay, so I didn't know that, you know, use of salt, mixture of salt and lemon, and then you can clean the piano keys. When I have sore eyes, sometimes I rinse my eyes with salt water. It works for me. I don't know if you guys have tried this. Salt and soda. will sweeten the odor of your refrigerator. Okay? So we can spend another 10 minutes just talking about the use of salt, because when I read, the list was about 60. Okay, 60 things that you can use salt with. But I'm glad that Lynn immediately said to preserve, okay, preservation, okay? In the centuries before modern refrigeration, using salt was the method to prevent bacteria from poisoning food, okay? Just as salt prevents or kills bacteria in food, we, the disciples, having the salt in us means we are being preserved not to lose our identity, or else we'll be rotten, right? So if we have salt in us, we are preserving our identity as a Christian. With all the corruption in the world and earthly temptation, people definitely have lost their identity as Christians. I have met a lot of people. They change because of worldly wisdom, not because of kingdom wisdom. People change. We change, you know. Sometimes you will see somebody who's very faithful on the pew. After 1 or 2 years, no. Why? Because this person might be tempted with worldly wisdom, or sometimes this person is having just a little, I want to call it like offbeat, you know, offbeat for months only. Okay? People change, we can change, but we cannot lose our focus, and we cannot be influenced by the corruption of our nation or corruption of the world. We are called to be the salt of the earth, not only for our own benefit, okay? We cannot be selfish. Not for our own benefit, but for the benefit of our community, for the benefit of our nation, for the benefit of the world, okay? We cannot lose this quality of being Christ-like if we are not being preserved. Just like what Alan said, we can lose our flavor, because salt brings flavor, right? So we can lose our flavor. We cannot be complacent. Our Christian life cannot be plain and simple or bland, B-L-A-N-D, okay? Being a Christian is not simple, okay, right? It's always complicated. Being Christ-like make us distinct from the society around us, okay? And we are set apart from others for great purposes. I want to ask you this one. What are the qualities of being Christ-like that we must preserve? If you believe in Christ, what are your qualities?
Kind, loving,
forgiving,
accepting,
generous, honest, more?
Humble.
Okay, wow, you guys can preach. Okay, love of neighbor as ourselves, and forgive one another in Christ as Christ has forgiven us. And what does the Lord require of us? To do justice to all, not just within our family, our circle of friends, our church community, but to do justice to all, and remember to walk humbly always with God. You cannot just walk as a Christian by yourself. Always walk humbly with God, okay? And if we no longer have this in us, these qualities, okay, we can no longer have a positive impact in our society. To be salt of the earth means we have to have an impact, not just you're there, you know, you're sitting here every Sunday. It's not like that, my brothers and sisters. We need to have an impact, a good and positive impact. We are being preserved. We are the salt of the earth. We are to preserve and confront the corruption of the world, okay, the injustices of the world. We are not just set apart for our identity, but we need to influence others because we have Christ in us, okay? Part of the church task is to live according to its nature. We as a church, we need to be alive. Are we alive?
Yes.
Are we alive?
Yes.
Are we vibrant?
Yes.
Okay, to live our calling, to be hopeful, to believe that God is with us no matter what our circumstances are, to be forgiving, Sarah said, to be generous, to be patient with one another, it's very important, and to extend help always to those people who are in need, and most of all, when we are salt of the earth, people will see that we are joyful. Why? We are joyful because we have Christ in us, and we understand that Christ is always for us. If we lose the flavor, it is the same thing as denying the presence of God in our lives. I will repeat it. If we lose the flavor, if we don't have the saltiness, people will see, what happened to Pastor Nori? God is not present with her anymore. We cannot be like that. So remember always, we are the salt of the earth. Okay? Next, you are the light of the world. Okay? Another must-have quality or function of a believer is to let our light shine before others. Okay? Don't let it shine just for our church family, but also those people outside our faith community. We are the light of Christ, bearers of Jesus Christ. I want you to shout out now. Can you shout out the darkness that you are seeing in our world today? The darkness that you are seeing in our world today. Violence.
Prejudice.
Greed.
Hunger.
Anger. Homelessness. Did I hear something?
Depression.
Racism. Okay? When Jesus said we are to be light of the world, this light represents the Christian good works. Remember the kids? No, they were saying even the flavor. These are the good works, okay? That we must do with so much integrity so that all who sees us, all who witness this light, may see Christ in us, okay? The light in us, the light that is shine before others, okay? If Karen is shining with all her smile and brightness, you know why? Because this is a reflected light from Jesus Christ. It only comes from Jesus Christ, no other. Not because she has a good job, not because she has a good family. Not only that, always the light in us is reflected because we have Jesus Christ in us. And we must tell the story of Jesus to our community. When we are the light of the world, it's like telling a story to our community, to our nation, to our world. We cannot function as a lamp. I'm glad that Sue, like everything that I need in my sermon is here, salt, you know, and the light. Okay, we cannot be a lamp. Okay, if one is not holding the lamp high enough for the light to be spread in the entire room. Okay, if you are a lamp and you're hiding it under a closet or under the table, what's the purpose then? You're not living out the purpose you are being called for. Paul understood very well the difference of light when one is connected to Christ. When you are connected to Christ, when we are in Christ, we as the faithful servant does not rest on wisdom of the world, but we rest only on the wisdom of God. Remember that. We cannot be contented because we have things here on earth. We have to focus and we have to look forward, move forward to the eternal kingdom of God. We have our Christ-like wisdom and gifts. It comes through the Holy Spirit so that we can truly be the salt of the earth and light of the world. And the last part of the gospel, okay? Jesus came not to put an end on the law. Jesus came to fulfill the law. Fulfill means, help me. Fulfill means what? To complete. Fulfill means what? Able to accomplish. Come on. One more. Fulfill means to fill out, also to expand. Okay? What is Jesus trying to do? He is trying to wake us up. He is trying to shake us up. Jesus came to give fulfillment of God's long-standing desire for God's creation. Okay, to be characterized by both internal attitudes and external action, obedience and holiness. obedience and holiness. In Jesus Christ, we need to pursue being like God. We need to pursue being in God. Just as we heard, we are blessed from our reading of the Beatitudes last week. We are called again to selfless giving. To be the salt and light of the world is not a glamorous qualities or function of a disciple. Okay? It's always a challenge if you believe in Jesus Christ. Do you agree with me? Right? You are tempted. And then you have that mindset now. You are more careful. Last time, when I was a kid and I don't understand the meaning of I accept Jesus Christ and Savior, 1-5 times I will lie to my mom and dad. White lies, okay? White lies. But when I realize getting older and you realize you accept Jesus as a Savior, your mind, you have that discernment. You are careful, you are challenged. Okay? You don't give in immediately to the temptation of the world. And when we receive our blessing, when we are being rewarded, thank God, praise God. But one cannot ignore, cannot put aside the mission of the church. Your mission, your personal mission. We cannot be called believer or followers of this Jesus Christ if we are ignoring the jobless, if we are closing our eyes and shutting our ears to the homeless and to the hopeless. We cannot be called believer or follower of disciples of Jesus Christ if we are not living out our innate qualities and functions, salt of the earth, light of the world. Let us ask ourselves, for the past week, have we answered these people's calls? Did you hear any jobless person? Did you hear the homeless cry? Did you hear any hopeless people or the sick? Have we at least tried to help these people? Don't say it's the job of the pastor. It's the job of the lay leader. It doesn't work that way. Church comprises all of us, not just your pastor, not just the volunteers. Have we at least prayed for them? If physically we cannot be there to help them, have we at least prayed for them? That's one way of being salt of the earth and light of the world. I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. Matthew 25 verses 35 to 39. And remember Jesus said that when you have done it for one of the least of these brothers and sisters, you have done it for me as well. Leave the divine calling, my brothers and sisters. Be the light of the world so that we can practice peace and justice, starting in our own very nation, and then we can be a part of the liberation of the world we live in. Our calling as a disciple is always challenging. It's not easy. But if we maintain that quality and function of being salt of the earth and light of the world, we can be an effective disciple of Jesus Christ. We will never be perfect, but we can always be effective salt of the earth and light of the world. This is the message of God for all of us, the people of God. Amen. Amen. Let us all stand and sing, "We Have a Story to Tell to the Nation."
Story to tell to the nation.
Please be seated. It's now time to share our joys and concerns. Updates, Alan.
Okay. Told you I'd get you later. Right now, we finally identified the source of Jacob's infection. Mm-hmm. MRI was needed because it was rather deep. And now we know what drugs to treat it with. So assuming he responds well, which so far he is, he should be coming home by Friday.
Okay.
We don't know if there's going to be anything else needed. We'll talk about that some more with the specialists on Wednesday.
Okay. So continue to pray for Jacob. I was surprised about your job.
Yeah, well, let's say the other thing too. Don't panic, I got a 5-month severance package.
Okay.
So it's not like I'm gonna be broke anytime soon. I mean, he's got 20 years, so.
Okay.
So they're taking care of me. I've got some friends, options, contacts that I've made during those 20 years, and so I'm not panicking.
Okay. Prayers are working so fast.
People, I just want to say one thing without getting too sermony about it. A lot of people, their self-identity is with their jobs. And when they lose their jobs, they can really feel the pain of loss of self. But I see myself first as a minister of Christ. I don't lose that job.
Good.
So, this is a bump in the road. It's an inconvenience, but we're going to, we'll grind through it.
Okay.
I'm not too panicking.
Extension of sermon. Okay, thank you, Alan. Praise God. Continue to pray for Jacob, and just like the prayer vigil, which starts Tuesday. Starts at 7 a.m. Sally? 7 a.m., right? 7 a.m. Okay. Any other joys and concern? Joyce, I'm happy to see Harry. I'm glad. Thank you, Brett. Thank you, Brett, for bringing Harry. Okay. And Donna. Okay. Cindy? Blood pressure, okay. Please pray for Janice. Her blood pressure is quite high, huh? Okay. Janice. Any other prayer requests? Joyce. Wow, we're quiet. Beth.
Leslie, Lynn.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So Lynn, Gail, April? Our April?
Our April.
Our April. So, okay, so if they don't sign up their birthday, can we take note, Caroline? Okay. Okay, Gail is on Wednesday. Lynn is Friday. April is today?
No, she's at Super Bowl.
Ah, Super Bowl, Houston. Oh, okay. Okay. Any other joys or prayer requests? Sigrun.
Joy, thank you very much for the prayer requests for getting my son in law. He had a 5.5-hour operation, and the doctors came out with the neurosurgeons and said it went very well.
Okay, what's his name again?
Glenn.
Continued prayers for Glenn. Where is he now?
He's at home.
At home, okay.
Because he insisted to go home, he had some papers.
Oh. Okay,
continued
prayers for Glenn. Sometimes people are more comfortable at home.
Jacob agrees with him.
Look at that.
Serious.
Yeah. Okay, any other prayer requests? Joyce? Am I forgetting something? Okay, we're beyond announcements. Worship committee meeting next Sunday, okay? To plan for Lent, okay? Any other prayer requests? Pray for our kids. I'm glad they're here. I get so much from our kids, really. I say something and immediately they know it already, right? We're so blessed. Thank you for the Sunday school teacher, the parents who are really guiding them. Let us go to God in prayers. Gracious God, we thank you for the light that we receive in Jesus Christ, revealing unto us your holiness and your righteousness. By your light we are encouraged, and we are equipped to shed light into the darkness of life. We are reassured to to see your face turned into our direction, bidding us always to come unto you, O God. And we long to keep your law and to keep your will. Lord Jesus, when you were on earth, they brought the sick to you and you healed them. Today, we ask you to bless all those in sickness and to bless all those in weakness, to heal and give comfort to those who are in pain. We ask you to help us to be healing people in our time and in this place and beyond, O God. May our love touch others, and may we help all the people to live in peace. As confident children of God, let us pray the Lord's Prayer in whatever language we are comfortable with. Ama namin na namin, suma sa langit ka, sambahin ang ngalan mo, mapasa amin ang kaharian mo, sundin ang loob mo dito sa lupa para nang sa langit. Bigyan mo kami ngayon ng aming kakanin sa araw-araw, at patawarin mo kami sa aming mga sala para nang pagpapatawad namin sa mga nagkakasala sa amin. At huwag mo kaming ipahintulo sa tukso, tadya mo kami sa lahat ng masama, sapat kayo ang kaharian, kapangyarihan at ang kadakilaan magpakailanman. Amen. 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 Shalom. Let us share the peace and love of Christ to everyone. Your presence is always a blessing. Let us offer our tithes and offering to God. Let us all stand for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings.
bless the giver and bless our gifts. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, with great kindness, you lead your people. You give wisdom to help us recognize Christ as the Lord of glory. Enlighten us by your Spirit to discern how to use the gifts that you have bestowed on us. May all our church ministries serve as channels of your powerful grace to people in need of help. We dedicate these tithes and offerings through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Christ, our Lord, invites us to his table, all who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God, and to one another.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from the slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit.
On the night in which he gave up himself for us, Jesus took the bread. He gave thanks for it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, eat this. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood.
By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. As we are one body, we are all invited to the table of love and reconciliation. Come, we will be doing communion at the altar railing. The body of Christ given for you. 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 Grace, the body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. To partake the holy communion elements, be reminded of the calling to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Go and serve in the name of God. Amen. Partake the communion elements, reminded you are called to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Go and serve in the name of God. Amen. body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ broken. The body of Christ broken. The body of Christ broken. The body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. You have to remind me. Sorry. The body of Christ broken for you. Everyone is included. You just have to remind me, okay?
Even the ushers.
Yes. Yeah.
Ushers and lay ministers are also invited to the table.
The body of Christ.
And organists, that's right.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy memorial of history in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us all stand and sing our last hymn, Forward Through the Ages.
Thank you.
Benediction. The Spirit of God is upon you and has anointed you. You are the salt of the earth and you bring light to the world. God's peace be with you all. Please be seated.